Domain names and other trademark issues on the Internet. The learning outcomes include: we will describe who has priority in registering a domain name. We will discuss who makes decisions on domain names. And we will explore laws that may apply in disputes over domain names on the Internet. Let's look first at who is in charge. If we go back to 1992, the United States recognized there was a need for someone to oversee the registering and assigning of domain names, and they authorized Network Solutions to be that person. Now, since then, we've moved to ICANN, the Internet Corporation for Assigned Names and Numbers. And importantly, the U.S., through the Department of Commerce, got out of being involved in assigning names in 2009. ICANN is a not-for-profit public benefit corporation. It works to keep the Internet secure, stable, and able to work together, interoperable. It does try to promote competition, and with its members, it develops policy on how the Internet's identifying system works. It also looks at how to expand the domain names to make it easier to recognize sites. On this slide, you can see some of the domain names that are used. You see top-level domain names, or TLD, that you probably recognize: .com, .org, .gov, .uk. And then you have subdomain names below those. They are expanding, and we will look at how they've expanded shortly. When the Internet was born and domain names began to be registered, at first, they simply assigned names on a first-come, first-served policy. That seemed to be the easiest thing to do. However, they began to notice that people liked to register trademark names, and if they didn't have a reason to do so, they might put those names on hold. Now, you can see how ICANN functions. You may have intermediaries between the person wanting to register the domain name and ICANN. They work in partnership with many different people to make sure that it's for the public good. Domain names do have trademark attributes simply by their name. Coca-Cola, you identify with Coke. Walmart, you identify with Walmart. So you have to be careful when selecting domain names not to infringe on the rights of others. At this time, I would encourage you to pause the slideshow and look at the YouTube video on priority domain name registration for trademarks. Let's now look at a seminal case in looking at domain names on the Internet: Panavision International versus Dennis Taupin. Well, Taupin set up a website that had aerial views of Pana, Illinois. Panavision obviously wanted this website, and so Mr. Taupin demanded that they pay him $13,000. He registered Panaflex.com, but did not use it. He did not sell anything. So when Panavision sued, both domain names were placed on hold. The court decided that Taupin had violated the Federal Trademark Dilution Act because the Panavision marks are famous. He was trying to make money, so it was commercial, simply because he demanded Panavision pay him $13,000. Use of Panavision does dilute the mark, because people may come to this website and not be able to find the brand they expect. So the court found that Toppin violated federal and state dilution statutes and had to stop. The significance of the Panavision case is that it was the first domain squatter, cyber squatter, that we had. The courts made it clear that they would apply traditional trademark laws and regulations to domain names. So this was a very important case in cyber law. The courts further found that cyber squatting, this was our first cyber squatter that went to court, can violate trademark rights simply by diluting the original brand. There is now in place Anti-Cyber Squatting Consumer Protection Act, and you see it all the time where people used or registered or tried to get trademarks of a famous company. Obviously the best thing to do if you are that company is to register every variation of your name you can find. You might want to pause the video now and look at the Anti-Cyber Squatting Consumer Protection Act video. Well, we have complexities with international domain names as well. Of course, names are going to overlap internationally, or words will have different meaning for a different company internationally. The main thing to do is to make sure your organization is vigilant about protecting the trademarks, which is a form of intellectual property, and to pursue vigorously others who are diluting your trademark or using it without permission in the global economy. Best thing to do is to get a lawyer who's familiar with international rules. When you look at trying to resolve domain name issues, well, people were aware that there are some issues with it, there's some problems. If you look at the history of domain names, and this is simply before 1998, at the very bottom, you see you have the standard .com, .edu, etc. In 2000, a few more were added, and now we're up to today, and what they've done is increase the number of domain registrars, which reduces the U.S. influence. Moving to ICANN was also a way to reduce U.S. influence because some people thought the U.S. had too much influence on domain names, giving preference to companies that were based in the U.S. They have increased the number of generic top-level domain names. Of course, we now have country code top-level domain names. Directory systems are used more, and they've looked at using expedited dispute resolutions when you have domain name conflicts. I encourage you at this time to take a look at the video on new top-level domain names. Let's take a look at a case, Shields versus Zuccherini. And in this case, Shields is, he designs cartoons under the name Joe Cartoon. He registered joecartoon.com. Zuccherini came in and registered every variation he could think of on Shields' domain name. And once you got into his site, you were mousetrapped in there. You could not get out. Advertisements would continue to open. Pop-up windows would open. It'd be very difficult to get out of the site. So Shields sued and said Zuccherini had violated the Anti-Cyber Squatting Protection Act. Zuccherini then changed his sites so that they were political protest pages against Shields. And you know, if you have a site that's satiring, critiquing, or parodying a famous name, you are allowed to do that under U.S. law. In this case, the district court said Shields, they ruled for Shields, and Zuccherini appealed. The decision of the court was that Joe Cartoon is a distinctive trademark, that Zuccherini sites are confusingly similar, that Zuccherini had no reason to have those domain names. He had no intellectual property rights. He was trying to get customers from Shield's site to come to his site. It does harm the goodwill associated with the mark because the customers were then mousetrapped in that the Zuccherini site. In addition, Zuccherini was a serial cyber squatter. He had registered many domains names that were confusingly similar to other trademarks. They qualified this case as exceptional and said damages were appropriate. Thus, they affirmed the district court's decision. In a very unusual twist, Zuccherini actually went to jail. He was reported as owning 5,500 domain names before his arrest, and he was released, but he was a serial cyber squatter, and the courts felt that his violations were so severe that he should face criminal penalties in this case. Madonna is a famous trademark that many of you are probably familiar with. In this situation, Dan Parisi purchased Madonna.com from a previous owner for $20,000. Then Parisi registered Madonna as a trademark in Tunisia. He operated an adult entertainment portal site, getting people to come in by getting them to see the name Madonna. He did have a disclaimer on his site that said, "We are not affiliated with Madonna." In June of 99, Madonna did object. Shortly thereafter, Parisi did remove the explicit sexual content on the site, and he tried to sell his mark or his domain name to Madonna Hospital, who would have a valid argument for wanting the name Madonna. Madonna then went the global route, or her lawyers did, and filed a complaint. Parisi said, "I'll take a three-member panel to decide the case." The decision? Well, the disputed name and the complainant's mark were identical. Parisi used Madonna. Parisi did not have any legitimate interest in the domain name. Simply registering the trademark does not necessarily give him legitimate interest in the domain name. Parisi also demonstrated bad faith because he was trying to profit off of Madonna's name. The disclaimer after people got into the site does not overcome the bad faith that Parisi exhibited. They decided he should transfer Madonna.com to Madonna. In another case, you've got Edward Van Halen, you may have heard of him, versus Deborah Morgan. So in this case, Deborah registered EdwardVanHalen.com. She is a Van Halen fan, and she wanted to use it as a fan website. Miss Morgan did concede that Van Halen had rights to the trademark and that her domain name was identical. However, in this case, Van Halen did not show any bad faith on Miss Morgan's part, and this transfer of the site was denied. She was using the forum to express her opinion of Van Halen, which was very positive. You have probably all seen sucks sites. Virtually every well-known trademark out there is going to have a site where people go to complain about whatever it is they don't like. Walmart sucks, Coca-Cola sucks, whoever it might be, they're all out there. Obviously, companies wish these sites were not available. In the US, however, you cannot suppress free speech. Free speech is one of the foremost guidelines that the court uses when deciding cases. So trademark laws will not allow you to suppress the free speech of those who may want to say that company, that organization sucks. If instead you register walmartsucks.com and that's really a Target affiliated site, then you might have an argument if it's not used as a way to express your unhappiness or criticism of the organization. Some people argue, could a domain name with a trademark followed by sucks really be confused with the trademark? In the English language, probably not, but the argument is sometimes in other languages, it could be an issue. One thing they're looking at doing is having .sucks domain names to make sure you understand these are criticisms of organizations, just like .org is organizations, .gov is government affiliated, .uk is United Kingdom affiliated, and so forth. You might want to take a quick look at the video about domain names that end in .suck and take a look on YouTube. Another case emerged that was Vivendi versus J. David Salen. In this case, the disputed domain name is VivendiUniversalSucks.com. Well, yeah, it could be confusing similarity because you added sucks to Vivendi, especially for non-English speakers, as we mentioned. The person registering the name, you look to see did they have legitimate interest. In this case, J, Mr. Salen, redirected his site as soon as the suit was filed. He did have no rights or legitimate interest in the domain name. They found that Mr. Salen did register this site in bad faith. He deliberately registered a name similar to Vivendi with no legitimate interest and should transfer that site back to Vivendi. However, this is a very unique case because he did not use the site as a way to express criticism of Vivendi in this case. In the US, free speech almost always is the overriding factor. It wins, it prevails. An example, Christopher Lamparello registered Falwell.com, and he used the site to criticize Reverend Jerry Falwell's views on gays and homosexuality. Of course, he was sued. And an appeals court in 2005 said the domain name was not infringing because Mr. Lamparello was not gaining financially from visitors who mistakenly arrived there. He does not violate anti-cybersquatting rules either because he used the domain name to criticize Falwell's views. Free speech almost always wins out in the U.S. Another example, you've heard of PETA. PETA.com was registered to make fun or satire the animal rights group PETA. PETA refers to people for the ethical treatment of animals. They registered the site PETA.com and referred to it as people eating tasty animals. Kind of a humorous satire of the name. In this case, it was different from the Falwell case because this individual had a history of being a cyber squatter, and he said on the site specifically, PETA, make me an offer, and I'll shut down the site. In sum, you can register a domain name that's similar or even identical to a trademark without violating trademark rights, as long as the site is used solely for criticism or parody or satire or to promote your views on whatever it is that has the trademark attributes, and you're not trying to profit from that. One way that we find websites when we're searching online is through the use of meta tags, which are embedded within every site you ever visit. Meta tags do help search engines find what you're looking for. So if I want to put in computer or laptop, it's going to give me information related to that. If I put in buy small notebook, it should be able to give me that. It'll probably give me spiral bound notebooks too, but I'll be able to refine my search. But some sites have, to try to circumvent what I'm looking for, they've embedded names of famous trademarks within their site so that when I search, it'll give me their domain as well as the one I'm looking for. So say I'm searching for Microsoft and Apple comes up because they've embedded the Microsoft trademark within their meta tags. In this case, the courts will look and say, are they infringing? Is it likely that people will confuse these two marks? Or maybe I'd say, oh, I didn't think about an Apple laptop. Maybe I will buy one of those. Is it likely to confuse me, or is it likely to dilute the original trademark? In general, trademark owners have won cases of this type when the word that's used in the meta tag has no connection to the site. Another case that looks at some of these issues is Brookfield Communications versus West Coast Entertainment. In this case, the court said that the use of another trademark was used to get the customers into the site, initial interest, even though you didn't complete a sale as a result of the confusion. In this situation, using trademarks and those meta tags may be infringing because I initially thought I found what I was looking for. Then maybe as a customer, I recognize that the website is different, but I stay there and decide to buy an Apple laptop instead. It's only when the meta tag is in there to trick me into coming into that website instead of the one I was hoping to find. So when is including trademarks within your meta tags a lawful use? Well, if I can't identify it without using the trademark, perhaps I have a product that's, you see this all the time at Walmart, a product that's similar to Advil PM, and it's ibuprofen with the PM part of it added, the Benadryl, diphenhydramine, I think. So I have that, and the only way I can let my customers know what that is, because it's called diphenhydramine ibuprofen, is to say, compare to Advil PM. So in that case, the consumers may not know what I have unless I use the original. It's only used in good faith for me to help my customers identify what it is I'm offering. And if you have a domain name with this, when you use the trademark in it, it does not suggest endorsement or anything else of the original trademark owner. Looking at another case, Playboy versus Netscape. Search engines had a list of terms with banner ads. As you search, you get banner ads that are tailored to your keywords. The list contained Playboy and Playmate. Playboy said, no, you can't use those words. They are our trademarks. You're infringing, you're diluting our mark. And the district court granted summary judgment, which says, even given the facts that we all agree on in this case, Playboy would lose at trial. It was appealed, and on appeal, they found that yes, Playboy's marks are strong, the type of goods offered is close, and the marks are identical, so customers may be likely to come into that website because of initial interest confusion. The use is not a fair use, since they could have used other words for adult banner ads. I'll let you think of some that might be appropriate. However, they said summary judgment was not appropriate. The Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals then said, a significant number of users think that advertisements that are keyed to Playboy and Playmate are really associated with Playboy. Then the customer may look at those ads and think they are not as good as Playboy, thus diluting its trademark. However, they agreed that summary judgment was not appropriate and sent it back to district court for further proceedings. So it wasn't enough to give summary judgment and make them stop using it. It had to go back and be looked at again. And it was likely then settled out of court. You've probably seen adware before when you look at when you do searches online. And adware is just software that we get with advertisements when we download an app or a program or whatever it is. Usually we're notified through that ClickWrap license that none of us read. We should. It'll say, would you like to download X? Some Netscape with this, and it'll already be checked. You have to opt out. Well, 1-800-CONTACTS didn't like the way this worked out and sued WinU. When people searched and got to the 1-800-CONTACTS to buy contacts for your eyes, they saw competing products. The use of trademarks, however, to launch ads doesn't necessarily mean that you have infringed on a trademark. It might be similar to the grocery store putting Coke and Pepsi next to each other on the shelves. They are competing products, but you're allowed to see both of them. I encourage you to take a look at the video that gives you a brief overview of malware, adware, and phishing. Well, how about auction sites? Are they responsible when counterfeit or inferior products are sold on their site? Tiffany thought so. Tiffany, the jewelry, or they make a lot of different stuff. But Tiffany versus eBay. In this situation, eBay does make significant investments to combat counterfeiting. But it didn't go quite as far as Tiffany had hoped they would. The court said eBay may use Tiffany on its website so people will know what they're buying. Using those keywords and meta tags does not violate trademarks. eBay is not liable when others infringe on Tiffany's trademarks. They're not a contributory trademark infringer. You can't apply liability in this situation just because eBay knows that some people, a small percentage of people, do sell counterfeit goods. And they made a good faith effort not to allow it to happen. Yes, their initiatives were not as good as Tiffany would have liked, but they had invested significant money into its significant protections into making sure that the sellers did not advertise counterfeit goods. Some would argue that eBay was a contributory or even a vicarious trademark infringer. Contributory, you should have known, vicarious, you profit from it. If eBay used the trademark to increase their business opportunities, then they may infringe, but in this case, they made investments. This is similar to issues you see with peer-to-peer file sharing. eBay is not a stranger to being sued for trademark infringement. A little more recent one that hasn't been decided, it was just in 2015, Wemo Labs against eBay. They allege trademark infringement, contributory trademark infringement, and trademark dilution because they said that eBay knowingly and deliberately profits from selling counterfeit goods and fake products, and they should be liable. That case is still going through the courts, and we'll have to see how it ends up. Domain name testing is a practice that is largely gone away. But what you used to do, what people used to do, they would register a domain and taste it, see how it did for 5 days. They would see how many ads they got, and if they decided they didn't want it, they could return it for a refund within 5 days. And at one point, almost all domain names were being returned. They could then keep and pay for the domain names that turned out to be profitable. They would get ads and things like that from Google, Yahoo, etc. They would wait for a complaint, ignore the notice, continue to profit. As I said, however, it's nearly through as a process. They don't get as big of a profit as they used to from Google, Yahoo, and others. There have been many cyber-squatting judgments now against people who use this domain testing to infringe on trademarks. And now ICANN has come up with a consensus policy where you have to pay the full price if you delete more than 10% of the names you register in any month. Therefore, they saw a huge drop in those people who were deleting and domain testing. There are still a few bad groups out there, and there's still some top-level domains where you encourage people to do this, but it's really decreased. You may want to take a look at the video that's shown here where ICANN halts domain testing. I decided I wanted to look and see what two of our more popular social media sites do or say about trademarks. Well, Twitter says, "What is a trademark policy violation on Twitter?" And this is straight from their website, using a company or business name, logo, or other trademark protected materials to mislead or confuse others. Okay, that's fairly clear. I don't know what penalty I have if I use a trademark policy, but that's maybe spelled out other way in other places. Trademarks on Facebook. One of the frequently asked questions is, I want to post something on Facebook, but it might infringe. What should I do? Facebook's very unhelpful response is, we can't provide you with legal advice. If you're not sure, don't post it. Don't use someone else's trademark without their permission. If you've already posted, remove it. Okay, well, that's not very helpful, but they do have policies in place where they try to discourage people from using trademarks on their sites, and they have active security protection mechanisms in place to try to find the counterfeiters. They also will take them down if they get a notice from the trademark infringer. We've all seen the fake accounts on Twitter, on Facebook, on Instagram, wherever it might be. And Twitter and Facebook, they've gone to verification to show that these are the real people. In fact, some famous actors and baseball players, whoever it might be, they'll have the real Chipper Jones because somebody already had their account and maybe had the same name as them. Somebody like Chipper Jones, who used to play for the Atlanta Braves, his name is Chipper Jones as his nickname. There are probably many other Chipper Jones, a fairly common name, so somebody already had that. You might want to take a look at the video on how to recognize fake accounts on Facebook. Summing up what we've talked about here, well, there are many issues to consider when we're protecting technology intellectual property. There are some laws out there, but the laws are always behind. You cannot count on laws in the police or the FBI or anyone really to protect your trademarks, your intellectual property. Your company, your organization, or you have to be vigilant to protect all of your intellectual property, including trademarks.